enjoying this. I hope you are too. But we have two more great speakers in petto for you. So it's a great pleasure for me to introduce to you my former colleague from Princeton University, Amit Singer.
Okay, thank you very much, Ingrid, and thank you for the organizing, for inviting me to participate in this wonderful workshop, and also to arrange me to give the talk in this session after my original flight was canceled. So I'll talk about vector diffusion maps and the connection of Laplacian. This is joint work with other students and collaborators whose name will appear in the last slide. And I would like to motivate the theory by a specific application, which is an application in structural biology called cryo-electron microscopy. What is structural biology? Structural biology is the field of finding structures of molecules, three-dimensional structures of molecules that, and the classical way of finding structures is using X-ray crystallography. And numerous Nobel Prizes were awarded over the years for finding three-dimensional structures. But not all molecules, people know how to crystallize them. So there are many molecules of biological interest that nobody knows how to crystallize, and there is a need for alternative techniques. One of the alternative techniques is called cryo-electron microscopy. And what people do in cryo-EM is instead of crystallizing the molecules, they just freeze them in a very thin layer of ice. So the ice layer is so thin, say 100 nanometers of width. So if you look at it in the vertical direction using the electron microscope, when the electrons go through the ice layer, they see at most one molecule, or maybe no molecule at all. And beneath the ice layer, beneath the specimen, you have a camera or film, and every pixel just records the number of electrons that went through the ice layer. And so the model is just like the model in tomography, where the XY pixel in the ice image is just the integral of the electric potential created by the molecule, denoted by phi, when you integrate it along the beam of electrons. Now the point in cryo-EM, unlike classical tomography, is that the viewing directions, the beaming directions are unknown, because when the molecules are being frozen, each molecule just picks some random and unknown direction. And so what we get on film is actually a collection of many particles, many images, each of which correspond to a different molecule, all assumed to have the same structure, but different and unknown three-dimensional orientations. Every orientation we describe by a 3x3 matrix, an orthogonal matrix, an element of SO3. And the point cryo-EM is a typical inverse problem where we try to find the structure, the function phi, from the images, P1 to Pn. Now, the way usually people do it is first we find the unknown rotations, R1 to Rn, and then given the images and the seemingly now known viewing directions, then we can reconstruct phi using classical computerized tomography methods. So you could have asked me, why don't they take more than a single image per molecule? Why don't they just tilt the ice layer and get non-viewing directions like is done in computerized tomography? So the issue is that in single particle reconstitution, when the electrons go through the molecule, they destroy the specimen, they destroy the molecules themselves. So if you want to get low resolution images, then okay, you can do tilting series and get a series of images. But if you want to get high resolution to approach and get close to atomic resolution, then you can do only one image per molecule, and this is called single particle reconstitution. So here is a toy example. So on top you see a volume, but for now assume that you don't know what is the volume. You try to reconstruct it. And you try to reconstruct it from the 12 images that you have beneath the volume. And as you can see, they are unlabeled, so the ordering is not known. And the question is how to find the volume from the images below. Okay, so here maybe you can do something and only from some of the images you can make a clever guess and guess what is the volume. But in real life, the images are much, much noisier. So what I show you here are four images that were collected by Dr. Fred Sigwars from Yale Medical School. And it's just part of a large collection of images that we have for a specific molecule called the, it's a subunit of the ribosome. Actually, for this for this molecule, we know what is the three-dimensional structure. And in 2009, the Nobel Prize was awarded for finding the structure of this particular molecule. And so the question is, can we get the volume from such noisy images? So there are certain steps in the pipeline of finding volumes from such noisy images. And today I'll describe just one step called class averaging. The idea in class averaging is to use many of such images. So real data sets have 1,000, even 10,000, sometimes 100,000 different images. And the idea is to get cleaner images by averaging original noisy images that correspond to roughly the same viewing direction. But then you can ask, but we don't know the viewing directions. OK, so we need to somehow find images that correspond to similar viewing directions. And I will describe today how this can be done. Let me just show you that from such noisy images, one can indeed get a reconstruction. So that's something that one of my students did about a year ago. So it's not an optimal method for finding that we have now for finding structures. But what you see here are two, oops, I think this is not from the beginning. Let me run it from the beginning. OK. Wow, this is too fast even for me. OK, so now you see two volumes that are superimposed, one shown in yellow and the other in white. The yellow one is the true volume that we know from the Nobel Prize in 2009, shown at a given resolution. And the white one is our reconstruction. And as you can see, they are not exactly the same. There are some differences. And as I said before, we're still working on this problem, trying to make our methods better. But this just shows you that even though the images look very, very noisy, there is a signal in the images. And one can get volumes that are quite good. OK, so let's go back to the. So what is the class averaging problem? So here I illustrated using simulated images. So bottom right, you see a clean simulated image that I just did on my laptop. On top left, you see the same image, but I added Gaussian white noise. And I didn't add a lot of Gaussian white noise, so we can still see the features of the image quite clearly. Top right, you see the same image, but rotated by 90 degrees and different realization of noise. And now the class averaging problem, you say that I have a data set of 10,000 images. Can I find these two images that correspond to the same viewing direction, but maybe different in-plane rotations of the camera, understand that they correspond to the same viewing direction, register them, that is to do rotation alignment, and maybe if needed also translation alignment, because the images may not be centered, and get the images that you see on the bottom left, which is just the average of the two after a registration, where the noise is diminished a bit. So that's the goal in the class averaging process. And OK, so the cryo-EM people didn't wait for us mathematicians to come and help them. They started working on this problem a long time ago. And one of the popular methods is a simple clustering algorithm, where what they do, they first compute rotation invariant distances. So between any two images, say image I and image J, you try to align them. So you look at PI and PJ and try to find the optimal orthogonal transformation, O, in SO2 that aligns the two images. And when I say optimally aligned, you can use many different kinds of metrics. So here I'm just writing as the Euclidean distance, but it can be different kinds of metrics. And I'm not going into details about the metric now. And once you do it, you get a distance between image I and image J that they call the rotation invariant distance. And once you have distances between all pairs of images, you can try now to cluster the images using many of the clustering algorithms that we know, for example, like k-means. This is what they use in practice. And so the clusters now, what they do, they just take any cluster, average these registered images within a cluster, average them, and this produces the class averages. This algorithm works fairly well, at least from our experiments, from for relatively, say, medium level of noise. But the main problem with this approach is that you have outliers. Now, what do I mean by outliers? It often happens due to the high level of noise that we experience with the real images, that you may take two images from completely different viewing directions, but due to the fact that the two realizations of noise may be similar, these two images are going to be aligned well because the noise realization is aligned well, and then you may think that they should belong to the same cluster. And then what is going to happen is that you're going to average images from completely different viewing directions due to such outliers. So the name of the game is to find a way to get rid of such outliers and to really average images that correspond to the same viewing directions. The way we can picture outliers is to think of the images as nodes of a graph. So think of every projection image as a node of a graph. So if we have n images, we're going to have n nodes. And suppose that we put an edge between image I and image j if the rotational invariant distance between them is smaller than some threshold, say epsilon. So if the images were clean, there is no noise in the images, we expect the graph to be like a neighborhood graph over the two sphere. The two sphere because we have every image corresponding to some point of the sphere corresponding to its viewing direction. But when we have outliers, it means that we may have two images of completely different viewing directions that we put an edge between them. So these are shortcuts. So these kind of graphs are known in other communities that are doing network analysis, small world graphs. And the question is, can we detect such bad edges in the graph and remove them? So one of the ways that people in network analysis find bad edges is to count how many triangles an edge is a side of. So if we have a good edge, then we expect it to be a side of many triangles. Whereas if we have an outlier, just a random link, we expect it to be a side of much fewer triangles. But actually, in the Crowley endpoint, we can do even better than that. And we can refine the notion of what is a good triangle. And this is what I want to show you now. So when you do the alignment process, when we compare two images, image I and image j, we not only get what is the rotation invariant distance, dij, but we also get an optimal angle, the angle that aligns the two images. Let's call it oij. So oij is a transformation in SO2, just a rotation that aligns the two images. And when we look at three images, say image I, image j, image k, and when all of them belong to exactly the same viewing direction, then if you take the three images and you first align, say, image I and rotate it to align with image j, and then you rotate from j to k, and then you rotate back from k to I, the sum of the three rotation angles should sum to zero modulo 2 pi. So we should count only triangles that satisfy this approximate consistency relation. Okay, so we can do it for triangles. We can even do it, say, for cycles of any length in the graph. But the question, can we do it in some systematic way? And this leads to something that I call vector diffusion maps. So the setup of vector diffusion map is the following. And in the next slide, I'll show you that it goes much beyond the Crowley EM problem. So in the setup, we have a graph. So we have nodes I, j, and so on and so forth. And it's a weighted graph, underweighted graph. So between any two nodes, I and j, we have some weight, say similarity measure between the images or between the two nodes in general, wij. But beyond this affinity measure, beyond this just scalar affinity wij that we have between the two nodes, we also have a transformation, oij, that relates the two nodes. That's something that you often don't see in other graphs, but later I'll show you how we can accompany transformations to many other graphs. But in the prior endpoint, the OIJs are very natural. They are just the optimal transformation from image I to image J. And then the question is, how can we do a better organization of the graph? Say, if we want to find an embedding of the graph in a low-dimensional Euclidean space, when we have not just the scalar affinities, but we also have the automata transformations. And this is what vector diffusion maps is going to help us. So let me tell you before how I do it, maybe I'll tell you what is the intuition of what I'm going to do. So in other dimensionality reduction methods, for example, like diffusion maps or Laplace and eigenmaps and other methods, the way we try to embed a graph in Euclidean space is by saying that, okay, if we have two nodes, I and J, and there are many paths of, say, of length T that connect them, and by many I mean really a weighted sum, well, for every path there is some weight associated with it, given the weights from the edge itself, we want to put the nodes closer together. And if there are not so many weights, not so many paths, we want to put them further apart. So we do some path integration, and this path integration helps us to do the embedding. Now we also want to make use of the orthogonal transformations. So I'm going to do the following. I'm going to look at two nodes, say I and J. And now I'm not just going to count how many paths I have connecting I and J at length T, but also for every path that I have, I can also compute what is the overall transformation that takes me from node I to node J by just multiplying the transformations along the path. So now for every path, I'm not just having an affinity, a scalar affinity, but also a transformation. And in the embedding, I want to have two nodes closer together, not just if there are many paths connecting them, but I want the paths that connect them to be consistent. That is what I mean by that. I want the transformation that I go from I to J over different paths. I want all these different transformations to be the same, more or less. And how I do it in terms of mass, I'll show you in a second. Before I do it, let me now show you that we can do it in a much more general setting. So the setting is going to be the usual setting of manifold learning, where we have a point cloud in RP, say denoted, so the data points are denoted by x1, x2, up to xn in RP. And the manifold assumption says that these data points are not just a point cloud in RP, scattered points, but actually they lie on some low-dimensional manifold. Say a d-dimensional Riemannian manifold in RP, where d is much smaller than p. So how I'm going to get the transformations in this setup? So the game is very simple, and it uses PCA, which I guess is a theme that is mentioned here over and over again. So what we're going to do, we're going to pick a data point xi, and we're going to look at its set of nearest neighbors. And for the set of neighbors, we're going to do local principal component analysis. And if the points really lie on a low-dimensional manifold, then when we do PCA, what we get is the basis with the tangent plane to the manifold at the point xi. Now, if the manifold was flat, that is no curvature, then when we do the PCA game and we do local PCA at different points, then every time that we do it, we just get a basis to the same subspace. So the different bases that we may get are just an orthogonal transformation of one fixed basis. But if you play this game on a Riemannian manifold that has curvature, then you have different tangent planes, and the bases that you get span different subspaces. So if we do local PCA at point xi and denote the orthogonal the matrix OI whose columns, so it's a P by D matrix whose columns are just the basis to the tangent plane at that point, and we do local PCA at point j and we get a matrix OJ of size P by D, then we look at the matrix OI transpose OJ. So this is a D by D matrix. In the case of a flat manifold, this D by D matrix is just an orthogonal transformation. But in general, it is not an orthogonal transformation. And so what we do, we look for its closest orthogonal transformation in the Frobenius nonsense, or the Hilbert-Schmidt nonsense. Finding this closest D by D, closest orthogonal transformation, it's a very easy problem. You solve it using the singular value decomposition. It's something very old. And so between any two data points that are close, I and J, I now generated for you a transformation, OIJ, just like in the Quarian problem. What is the meaning of this OIJ in the manifold learning setup? I'll not prove it for you now, but we can show that OIJ is really an approximation of an operator that you learn in differential geometry, and this operator is known as the Pyle transport operator. So this is a picture that I stole from Wikipedia, but basically what it tries to say is that the Pyle transport is an operator that acts on tangent vector fields. So for example, you take a vector tangent to the sphere and Pyle transport it to another point on the sphere by sliding it along the geodesic. What this picture is trying to show you is that over the sphere, if you pick different paths, then the composition of the Pyle transport can give you different results. Okay, so now we understand what are the OIJs, both in the cryo-EM setup and the manifold length setup. How can we get a better embedding or better organization of the data using the affinities and transformations? So the steps that I'm going to show now are very similar to what people do in diffusion maps and in other dimensionality reduction methods. So we're going to construct an ND by ND matrix, S. It's a symmetric matrix, but I would like to think about it as an N by N matrix where the ijth entry is a D by D block. And this D by D block is nothing but the transformation Oij multiplied by the scalar affinity Wij. And if there is no edge, or if the affinity is zero, then I just put the zero block. So we can see that in general, this matrix is very sparse. Then I take this matrix, and I'm going to introduce another matrix, D. It's a diagonal matrix, but again, I would like to think of it as a block diagonal matrix, even if that is, it's diagonal. And what we have on the diagonal, the block diagonals are just going to be the weighted degree. So their guy is just the weighted degree of node number I times the D by D identity matrix. So we have S and D. And now that I have S and D, I can look at the matrix D inverse S. And I would like to now give you an interpretation of what is this matrix D inverse S. So when we apply D inverse S on some vector, so we need to apply to a vector of length N D, this is the size of our matrices. Let's think about this vector V, a vector of length N D, as N D-dimensional vectors. Every such D-tuple, think of it as a vector in the tangent plane associated with node number I. So we have such N tangent vectors. So the vector V, think of it as a sampling, as a discrete sampling of a continuous vector field over our data set, a tangent vector field over our data set. And now I'm just writing for you explicitly what is D inverse S times V. So we need to do a summation of Wij, Oij, Vj, and then divide by the degree of I. So node number I, look at its neighbors, say neighbor number j, and we have a vector Vj of size D. We parallel transport it using Oij to our own frame, to frame number I. And we weighted average all our neighbors. So we look at our neighbors, we parallel transport their vector fields, their vectors to our frame. We do averaging, and that's it. So what it means is that we have an averaging operator for tangent vector fields over our data. Using this averaging operator, now I can do a lot of things. So really, in order to do what I described to you before as finding the consistency between nodes, what I'm doing, I'm looking at my averaging operator, D inverse S. I'm raising it to the power of 2t. So think of t as the length of the path. This means that now I'm looking at all paths between I and j of that length. And to ask how consistent the paths are, I need some matrix norm, because now I'm summing many blocks of size d by d. So the matrix norm that I'm choosing is the Hilbert-Schmidt norm, the Frobenius norm squared. And I claim that this number, this positive number that I get by doing so, is an inner product in the Hilbert space. So to show you why this is the case, we write the matrix. So it's a symmetric matrix. We can write it in terms of its spectral decomposition. If we raise it to the power of 2t, then you just take the eigenvalues, raise them to the power of 2t. And so what I have here are L, so I have VL is the Lth eigenvector of the matrix, has nd of them. So I have nd eigenvector fields. And the Hilbert-Schmidt norm, what we see here, in order to calculate it, I'm calculating using the trace. And when you do the calculation, what you get is now a double summation over L and R. You take the two eigenvalues, multiply them, raised to the power of 2t. But more importantly, you take, for node I, you take the inner products between all eigenvector fields at tangent plane number I, and you take all inner products at node J, and this is what you get as your Hilbert-Schmidt norm squared. The importance of this formula is the following, because it shows that this is an inner product. And the way we can see it is by defining the vector diffusion map, Vt, where t is the time scale, that takes node number I and embeds it using nd squared coordinates, where the Lr coordinate is simply the multiplication of the eigenvalues raised to the power of t, this is the scalar, times the inner product between eigenvector field number L and eigenvector field number R in that tangent space. And you can see that if you take VTI and VTJ and take their dot product, then it just gives you the Hilbert-Schmidt norm squared. So what we constructed using our own intuition really boils down to an embedding of our graph in a Hilbert space, a finite dimensional Hilbert space in that case. So one more comment before we move on to the next slide is that the usage of inner products is very nice here in the sense that it is invariant to the choice of a basis. So when we do local PCA, we can maybe get MATLAB or whatever software you're using not to compute a PCA or SVD. It can give you many different bases, but the inner product is invariant to that choice. Once we have an inner product space, a Hilbert space, we also have distances. So we can define the distance between node I and node J by simply looking at the inner product of I with itself plus the inner product of J with itself minus 2 times the inner product between I and J. And this is the square distance that we call the vector diffusion distance. And in fact, to compute this distance, we don't need all nd eigenvalues. So the eigenvalues typically show a very rapid decrease. And to get approximate distances, we just need to take the top few eigenvalues and get approximate distances. And now we're going to use these distances to the application of ProRM that we discussed at the beginning. So this is like the before and after pictures. So on the left, we did the following experiment. We simulated 40,000 images at a given level of noise, very, very low SNR. And for every image, we searched for its 40 nearest neighbors in terms of the rotation invariant distance. And what I show you is a histogram on the left of the angle between a pair of neighbors that we found. So an angle close to zero means that we did a good job in identifying images with similar viewing direction. An angle that goes all the way to 180 degrees means that we have an issue with an outlier. And so you see a fat tail of outliers here. And in fact, about 50% of the images here, of the pairs of images, are just outliers. And on the right, you see the angle between images that whose vector diffusion distance was one of the 40 smallest ones. So now we look for nearest neighbors, not in terms of the original rotation invariant distances, but in terms of the new vector diffusion distance. And as you can see, most of the fat tail of outliers was completely chopped off. So about 92% of the images now in small cap of radius 20 degrees. How am I doing in terms of time? Usually it's the job of the organizer, but I think I'm running late. Yeah, I know. So I guess I will not take any questions, but I'm kidding. So if you have any questions, let me know, and I'll be here around for the whole workshop. So I promised that the names of the people that that are related to this work. So Hao Tiang Wu is working on is related to vector diffusion map, and Jane is working on the cryo-EM the classification problem. And I have collaborators, Fred Sigwas from Yale Medical School, who's providing us the images, Yoel Shkonitsky in Tel Aviv University, and Roni Adani. It's all related to this project. Yeah.
So with this primary EM stuff on viruses, a lot of times you know the virus is symmetric. So if you knew something like that, is it easy to kind of incorporate that into your framework, or is that kind of difficult?
Yeah, so if you have symmetric viruses, symmetric molecules, for example, this means that instead of having that, if you look at the viewing directions, they are not, now they are not on the sphere, but rather on the quotient space, where you mod out the symmetry group. So in terms of for example, if you're looking at the icosahedra, you have the finite group G corresponding to the icosahedra, and instead of looking at the sphere, you look at the sphere and you mod out this symmetry. So you really look at the orbit spaces, and you really compare instead of two points, you compare to orbits, but the frame that I presented here is just as well for symmetric molecules.